Greetings, Hotep, and Sawubona, and Gamshi Lakwan. So, Kamedian, Zulu, and Young Kala Kalapuya. Anyway, I wanted to start today by talking about, prior to the election in 2016, many people are freaking out. Various ways and expressing that concern to me, and I'm saying, what if you were born to be in this time? What would you do? How would you face it? Because what goes around comes around. This stuff has happened before. You know, 16 years of Reagan and Bush. The 50s. You know, over the weekend I was listening to, on NPR they had basically white women, some who were undecided, and some were Trump supporters, some were Clinton supporters. One of the Trump supporters was talking about, I just want my children to grow up in the same America that I grew up in, and she actually named the popular television show, Leave It to Beaver. Warden June Cleaver. So, you know, Ward worked in corporate America. June was a stay-at-home mom. You know, white picket fence, suburbia, et cetera, et cetera. And another woman basically said, you know, like during that time, in the 50s, it wasn't really a great time to be gay, black, Latino, poor. I'm not sure what you mean by that. And, you know, to basically blame 8 years of Obama being the worst race, you know, worst time and the worst awareness of race. No, I mean, I'm 61. We've had worse times. We're just talking about it now because we have a black president and it's like in your face. So, since my degrees are in Western psychology, I wanted to talk about oriented times N. Now, the N, as in algebra, is some number that you are going to find. So, in algebra, as a healing discipline, so that's, you know, basically what you've learned in this class is that algebra is also a healing psychological discipline. You structure your identity according to what you are taught by whoever you are taught. So it might be your biological parents, it might be your friends, it might be your Facebook friends, it might be all kinds of things, right? But in Western psychology, it teaches you to be oriented times three. So it's an actual thing. So if you're a head injured, one of the things that the paramedics do is they ask you three questions, oriented times three. In counseling sessions, we talk about the client, the patient was oriented times three. So it's a basic test for sanity, all right? So who you are, where you are, and who's president. Generally, you know, to orient you in terms of time, space. So notice within that particular framework, it's basically the physical. Okay, who are you? That is the name on your driver's license if you're old enough to have one. Where are you? You know, are you aware of what happened to you? Are you oriented? That's why oriented times three. And then what time is it? What are the current events? You know, do you recall those kind of things? I kind of looked at, what if you had a different orientation? Or what if that orientation wasn't enough for you? Because that orientation definitely places you as a physical being, but what about a spiritual being? So for example, if I were taking Naeem Akbar, taking a page from Naeem Akbar, then I would say you are soul-oriented times five, right? And that gives you the orientation that includes the physical, but beyond the physical. So this actually came from a poem where I, you know, kind of woke up from a dream. And in the dream world, you actually access, shall we say, non-physical dimensions to the degree that, and some of them may intersect this one. So, soul-oriented times five. So, in Naeem Akbar's construct, you are a soul. You are an individual being that's independent of the body. The soul is the actual person from that particular point of view, and this has its correlates with Kamedian thought. So, the soul, invisible essence. So, question number one. Who were you before you were born? Now, before you can generally answer that, and this isn't the order that you answer the questions, actually, but it's a good question to know. Who were you before you were born in this body? Who were you before you woke up? Because this is the world of dreams. And there are actually some Western psychologists like Roberto Assagioli who say, well, this is the spiritual dimension that basically you inhabit. So
they know for a fact that we go to other dimensions when we're sleeping.
Well, to answer that question, well, since we're talking about Western psychology, all right? So Freud, Jung, and a bunch of other people, William James, all these other people that basically talk about what Western psychology is. So Freud, superego, ego, id.
Yeah.
You know, so that three, that triune thing, just like oriented times three, that almost dates back to that time. Jung, basically the collective unconscious, that you see dreams can be interpreted in terms of symbology that's universal. So, and that's in the collective unconscious, archetypes, etc. And he will basically say that those are images, and that's why we recognize them. Native folks that encountered him said they're not actually images or metaphors, they're actually a separate reality, but, you know, that we participate in, but, okay, that didn't really get into his theory. Roberto Assagioli, an Italian who was a contemporary of Freud and Jung, his main thing is known as psychosynthesis. And so, basically, Freud thinks spirituality is a form of insanity. Jung doesn't say that it's insanity, but he says it's more imagery. It has meaning, but we give more meaning to it. Assagioli says, in psychosynthesis, healthy human psychology integrates the spiritual. That is an actual reality. So while you're awake, that's like being in daylight, okay? The sun is basically dominant, and you know, the sun is in the sky, and the sky is blue. The stars are still there, but you can't see them while you're awake. You only see them at night, and in dreams, you go to another place that is not necessarily your body. Your body, your nervous system reacts to it as if it's real. You know, like you're flying in a dream, you're falling off a cliff in a dream, you fade out just before you hit, you know. So if you die in your dream, do you really die, et cetera, et cetera. Assagioli would say, those places are just as real as this one, but you can only go there non-physically. You don't go there in your body, you go there in your consciousness. And wherever you go spiritually, you have to integrate that within your psyche, however you do that, whatever framework you use to do that. So where Australian Aborigines have a place they call the dream time, which they're saying there's no past, there's no present, there's no future. Basically, every place exists in the dream time. That goes along with the quantum physics idea that past, present, and future, those are actually illusions. You also have parallel universes. You also have alternate timelines. You also have all these different worlds
infinite
that are
dimensions.
That are infinite dimensions that are accessible in ways that we don't necessarily like to talk about because it's difficult to talk about. Our English language is not really set up to do that in terms of time travel,
or even
in terms
we are
of
think in general,
right. So however you think about it, I like to, you know, where I've talked about there is a Western basis for that thought, that you have an existence beyond the physical. It's not a new idea, not even in Western thought, but how do you access it practically, which is something we'll get into a little later. But
that all has to do with the pineal gland, right?
Pineal gland is only one physical structure that...
that's when it regulates your sleep and dreams, correct?
Well, it also regulates certain neurotransmitters and all those other kinds of things. So without getting into the specific physiology, let's just say that the capability is there without necessarily going crazy about it. So back to slide, if you would. All right, so who were you before you woke up? This morning, for example, or you could also talk about it metaphorically. When did you wake up spiritually, right? Who were you before you were born? Now, whether that's born again and again and again and again or whatever, that's another level you can answer that question. Who are you in your deepest dreams? Which has to go with who will you be in your life, that is, your life mission. So within Native American thought and African thought, no one comes into this world without a mission in life. No one. So part of your mission, should you choose to accept it, not impossible, is to find that life mission and follow it, and sometimes your dreams are indicators of what that is. And then finally, who will you be after you die? Because certainly in Comedian thought, you can choose where you are going after you die.
Do they believe in reincarnation too?
Yes. Well, early Christianity did as well, because again, Christianity is an African religion.
Is that why you get to choose where you go when you die, so that you can be wherever you want to be?
Yes, the judgment day comes after you die, and it's not the way, you know, you go to hell or whatever. Remember that Yeshua didn't believe in hell, right? But there is a period of time after you die where you review your life and decide where you're going to go next.
Okay.
But you know, very few people necessarily have come back to tell us, yeah, this is where... So it's very difficult to basically talk about this other than metaphor, but soul-oriented times five, right? Who are you before you were born? Who were you before you woke up? Who are you in your deepest dreams? Who will you be in your life? And who will you be after you die? So if your culture cannot ask and answer those questions, you can be controlled. So this is basically an identity formation that can be the prescription for self-mastery. Because once you no longer have a fear of death, then you can't be controlled. And your acts take on a particular power. That's the idea behind doing that, all right? So if you or your culture can't answer or ask those questions, you can be controlled. And to the degree that you can culturally self-define those answers, to that degree, you can be autonomous. That is, internal locus of control, as we say it in psychology, in the soul. So from a soul point of view, it doesn't matter what will happen tomorrow. We were born to be in this time. And in a timeless place, yeah, we saw this before. However it comes down. You know, that's why I say, look, we survived slavery, and we'll talk about that, and you know, the participation of African Americans as revolutionary citizens and also within chattel slavery. Because, yeah, we're not going back into the chains, and they can't, you know, lock up all 40 million of us in prison, but
that's just in this country, too.
That's just in this country, right? So, here we go. All right. So, black old school. You have to be twice as good. This is basically expressed as an algebraic equation. You have to be good, twice as good. This is what I was told as a youth. Ta-Nehisi Coates talks about this in his latest book, where he basically says, yeah, that old school formula, you have to be twice as good as the white man to be considered equal. And even then, you won't be considered qualified, basically qualified or ready. You'll be scary if you basically are that. This last week where we talked about, did I tell you about my Halloween story?
No.
All right. So I'm walking down, this is
Halloween?
Not this Halloween, but a previous Halloween. Right. Did I?
No.
Okay, I'm getting old, so I misremember stuff. So in those days, this is basically only like 4 years ago. So my locks were down my back.
Okay.
After more than a dozen years of growth.
Okay.
So I'm walking down West 11th in May, hot, sunny day, let my freak flag fly, whatever. Confederate flag pickup truck drives by. And they say, there's a lot of them. But, and they said, and somebody shouted from it as they passed me, Halloween's over. And I'm thinking, it's May. Halloween, yeah, Halloween's. Do you want to drive around the corner and come back and talk to me about that? Do you have the heart to do that? Because
No,
they didn't.
They only have the heart to drive down the street and yell at you.
So thereafter, you know, I spoke at City Club, and also my Halloween costume after that was basically wearing my LCC faculty graduation regalia, because for some people, being an educated black man with college degree is a scary thing.
Yeah.
Definitely in terms of hiring here at the U of O, because they have this lack of, you know, black faculty, and it's not because there aren't any, it's just that they're scared of them. And, you know, and that's not just my opinion, but the reality. All right, so I dressed up in my graduation regalia and had two Super Soaker Nerf guns, which were invented by Lonnie Johnson, a NASA scientist, who had just that week won a $47 million settlement from Hasbro.
For stealing his idea, right?
Well, no.
Stealing,
I mean, they owed him back royalties.
Right.
For the guns and all the Nerf stuff.
Because he worked for Hasbro, right?
Well, he basically sold the patent because, you know, you invent something and then you sell it to a toy manufacturer and they're supposed to pay you royalties.
Right.
And they owed him $47 million.
And they didn't want to pay him.
They hadn't paid him.
Sure. At all?
At all.
Not even for the patent?
Well, he had the patent, but, you know, that's why they had to pay him. I mean, because they manufactured and sold all those toy guns.
So he was able to keep the patent himself.
Yeah.
That's still in his name.
Yeah.
And he just sold the licensing to
Right.
Hasbro. Okay.
Right.
The licensing deal
Right.
with them.
Okay. All right.
Did he get paid eventually?
Oh, yeah. He did.
In a lump sum or?
Well, however the settlement worked out, I mean, they couldn't appeal.
But he had to sue.
Yeah. He had to sue to get it. Right. So don't mess with an educated black man and his money, all right? But again, people fear the educated black man. That doesn't mean if you are fitting that demographic, you don't do due diligence and make your A's and get your PhD and whatever else you want to do. But when the U of O law professor, the white female U of O law professor who at her private home showed up in blackface because of, I mean, okay. So when you have, when people have these devices, even if you are in your own home, you're public.
Yes.
You're public. And even though she said her explanation was, you know, she read this book by this black doctor who talked about being a black man in white coats, and she was dressing up as him.
You can do that without the blackface.
You can do that without the blackface. And speaking as the son of a black doctor, the brother of a black doctor, the father of a black medical student, and having lots of mentors who are famous, prominent black doctors, there's ways of honoring that.
You have a PhD, do
you? I have 3/4 of a PhD.
Okay. But you're a psychologist, so technically
yes.
You're a black doctor too.
Yeah.
Right. Minus the PhD.
All right. So, I was told not only do you have to be twice as good, but you have to know the king's or queen's history better than the king or queen, speak the king's English better than the king or queen, and what you have to know to beat the system. You have to know those things, right? And they're not going to be taught in school. So if you were going to express that as an algebraic equation, 2x, where x is the system, what the system wants you to know, plus y. So twice as much plus y. And that could be W-H-Y. Now, fortunately, that's not that difficult. But you have to learn beyond the curriculum. And I could go into a whole thing about hidden curriculum, but I want to stay focused on the system. All right, black old school. Twice as much as the system that keeps white privilege in power, for example. Plus Y. So, the matrix of domination has you. That famous line from Bob Marley, emancipate yourself from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. A little flat on the end, but didn't warm up. So this particular graphic, the matrix, even though I'll talk about this when we get into the 20th century more, but the matrix and the Matrix movie and the Terminator movie are basically the same story written by Sophia Stewart, a black woman who had that story ripped off by Warner Brothers and
she
Fox.
I mean, not that that means anything.
What?
Like,
the FBI agreed that her case had, that it was copyright infringement. Yeah, so she said that it wasn't about money, so in terms of, you know, getting money out of that, whatever, but she basically...
She just wanted the recognition that she...
She just wanted the recognition that she had actually written that, and basically what she was trying to do is basically learn about talk about a black superhero who used his powers of spirituality to overcome the machines,
yeah.
Right? And so that's why Zion is a multiracial society. That's why all the agents are white. And that everybody except for Neo, because Neo was supposed to be a black man, but they decided to cast Keanu Reeves, you know, in that role, because, you know, I mean, it's kind of like the logic of the movie Gods of Egypt. Like, wait, all the gods are white people.
That's way more egregious.
Like, yeah, Noah, white people. yeah, okay. How do you do that?
Passion of the Christ.
Passion of the Christ, yes, and the devil is a woman or whatever, or you know, anyway, woman of color.
Wait, the devil was a woman in that?
Yeah, devil always appears as a woman's voice. Yeah. All right. So the matrix of domination has you. So One of the things about empowerment, if you break that word up into its constituent parts, EM, that prefix, inside, like emic, emotion, energy that's moving inside. Power, that is the capacity to be effective, the ability to define reality, et cetera, et cetera, so that others define yours as your reality as their own. And ment, which means mind. So empowerment literally means inside power, mind, or power within mind, right? And that's how Neo overcomes the Matrix.
By the way, Will Smith was offered the role first, and he turned it down.
Well, there are other black actors besides
Will Smith. No, I think they offered to a couple, and they all turned it down, and then that's when they cast Keanu.
Yes. Well, they probably should have explained that it was written by a black woman rather than try to rip it off themselves. But
that's true.
Hey.
Making a new movie about Jesus, and Ewan McGregor is going to play.
What? For ew, he's no.
Yes.
Yeah, they're not getting any better.
No.
Yeah. Right. So the Matrix. So if you understand what makes you suffer, you can liberate yourself from your suffering. That's one of the messages in terms of Yeshua's teachings and the Buddha's teachings. Suffering comes from attachment to ignorance of self. So knowing yourself is freedom. And a key to escaping the Matrix. So the Matrix of Domination, about 800 years old. So when you the system of education, of the storytelling, the narrative, that Columbus discovered America, white supremacist capitalist patriarchy, separation, we're better than you, competition, survival of the fittest, ignorance of self and others, and basically ignorance of the power, what makes you powerful and what makes you powerful within, basically keeps you enslaved within the Matrix. Being a trekker, not trekkie. I also like the idea of the Borg, the assimilation. Basically, that same trope or metaphor. So I talk about crashing the Matrix. It definitely seemed apropos to at least introduce the concept and begin to be able to talk about that. So CRASH is an acronym for understanding intersectionality. That is, there are multiple systems of discrimination. So to give you conscientious Zaun, which that should actually be not yellow. Computers, they were supposed to set us free. Sorry to do this on the fly, but okay. Okay. Wow. Conscientious Zaun, that is in the original Portuguese. It's a word formulated by Dr. Paulo Freire, who was a Brazilian educator, who basically said there's two purposes to education. So when we're talking about identity formation, you are either, the purposes for education, because education is not neutral, is either to replicate the system as it is, or to liberate you from the system as it is. And so there's two different purposes. So conscientious Zaun, which is how you pronounce that, okay, learning to perceive social, political, and economic contradictions and take action against the oppressive elements of reality. Conscientious is sound. So it's a skill. So notice that there is no real equivalent in English. This is why it's wise to follow the African model and the other cultural models of speaking multiple languages simultaneously, because certain languages represent worldviews and they also represent ways of seeing. And the fact that conscientious Zaun doesn't exist in English, like conscientious, not the same. But conscious and politically active and economically active and spiritually active, that's what conscientious Zaun talks about. So the matrix of domination. So a matrix, basically a substance in which something is embedded or enclosed. Two, a situation or set of circumstances that allow or encourages the origin, development, or growth of something, in this case and context, humanity. The substance that exists between cells and from which tissue, for example, cartilage and bone, develops. For example, like the pirate flag, where you have two crossed femurs standing up on your own 2 feet in death, that is, you're dying to national identity and living free, because in those particular states where you're basically being a pirate and defined as a pirate, defined as a criminal, you're living free from their particular domination. The soil or rock in which something such as fossil, crystal, or mineral is embedded, a bed or surround of material that gives protection or absorbs a force, the womb, which is actually an archaic use of that word, like 19th, 17th century, somewhere in there, archaic. So this is from my onboard dictionary. So matrix of domination. So power is the capacity to act effectively. Individuals and societies can create structures to distribute that capacity equally upon attainment of maturity, or concentrate it specifically in the hands of a few. So we've looked at contrasting societies that do both, right? So if you have an indigenous democracy that basically empowers women, if you had an indigenous European society that empowered women, because women were the source of life, and however you believe that works, you give them power, because civilization is basically, you know, if you want to reduce it to its barest things, you're protecting pregnant women and children and having them grow, period. Anything else, okay. Yeah, don't pee or poop in other people's drinking water or your own drinking water, or, you know, that's civilization, right? So you can also then structure that society to basically have power in the hands of a few. And that's part of the matrix that we kind of grew up with in this society, this contemporary American society. So domination, power over. I keep the means to become effective to myself, to disadvantage you, and empowerment, power with, I share the means to become effective with you to advantage both of us. So for example, if you were going to look at the Matrix movies as a metaphor, The agents have power within the system because none of the humans recognize that they're in a computer-generated dream. So the computers have the power. Now, however that world came about, whether it was basically destroyed ecologically or whatever, and that humans had to go underground to basically be in this computer-generated dream. So let's see, what did they say? Yeah, this, you know, you're just a battery for this machine world, and then there's people who live really far underground, and there were cities that were, you know, vast and developed but largely abandoned. And most people don't recognize the reality that, oh, well, you can live free. Not, you can use computers, but you can be free and battling the computer-generated world, and, you know, within that particular mythology, because the only reason I use it in terms of essentially this civil rights struggle that we're involved in now is that you can empower yourself by becoming aware of the certain realities that put together the system. And you can take it apart and understand how it puts you in this particular situation.
Who do the architect and oracle represent then?
Well, again, when you think of, you know, this is a work of fiction, right? And so you have a black woman who's the oracle, right? Who basically says, you know, the architect, so you have like two hemispheres of the brain, right? I mean, that's one way of saying, right? So if you have the left hemisphere, which is the rational, orderly, logical, machine world, then that's the architect. And if you have the right side of the brain, which is the feeling, emotional side, that's the oracle. And you need both to basically generate the world. But over, you know, so for example, whenever Neo basically bests any of the agents, he relies on the spiritual, emotional framework. Right, and he had to depend on his inner sight to do that, and his spiritual sight to do that, because logically, the machines can't do that because they're machines, right? They're just created by humans, and they can only put in what people put in them, right? Which could not necessarily be the emotional world, but who knows?
It's common.
Yeah. All right, so crash. Classism, racism, addiction, sexism, heterosexism, and actually this is an early iteration of that. So for example, under classism, there would be militarism, because even though we're supposedly, we revere people in military service, we don't pay them. They don't have status. Look who goes and fights wars, and it's not rich people necessarily.
And then come home homeless.
Uh-huh, and then become homeless. So racism, so under that would be a hierarchy of religion and spirituality, which is basically racially focused. And think about who's on top and who's on the bottom. Addiction, ability, age. All right, so there are systems of discrimination that not only discriminate against you because of whether you drink alcohol or whether you smoke weed, whether you're an alcoholic or a heroin addict, whether you're a prescription drug addict or a street drug addict. There's a hierarchy of class there, age and disability. So it would be C squared, R squared, A cubed, sexism, and then heterosexism. And that gives you basically an easy concept to explore intersectionality, which is heterosexism, also known as homophobia.
Oh, gotcha.
heteronormative. I mean, again, with this meme came, you know, I created this meme in, you know, the early aughts, like 2004. So the terminology and the understanding has changed several times. So using the old word. So for example, here's one example of how the matrix works. So women constitute half the world's population. Close to half, but more than half.
Yeah.
The majority.
Yeah, isn't like there more women than men, right?
Yeah, always have been.
Yes.
Perform nearly 2/3 of its work hours.
Does that include child rearing and
everything?
Okay.
Everything. Receive 1/10 of the world's income. And own less than 1/100 of the world's property. And this is from a United Nations report in 1980. That those things remain constant means there's a matrix holding them in place.
Wait, so none of these numbers have changed since 1980?
Essentially unchanged.
That's 36 years. That's
even in America, a woman has yet to crack the 80%, you know, of every dollar a man earns, a woman earns about 79 cents.
73, I thought.
Well, if it's 73, then it's dropped. Okay.
That's not good.
Okay. There is a matrix holding that in place. That is not an accident.
No.
Okay? That is not an accident. So the reason I use the word matrix is, oh, well, this is not an accident. This holds that in place. If that is true for women, and that is the basis, the economic, political, and otherwise basis of sexism, and sexism is the first discriminator. The first.
Sexism.
And it's the oldest.
Yeah, sexism came before racism.
Yes, sexism became before racism.
And classism.
Yes, you could say that. All right, so these conditions are replicated and held in place by a matrix of domination, which is our contemporary word for it, which basically prevents access to the power to become effective, however that power is in existence. One way you can gain that power is by, one, recognizing that it exists, that there's a power inequity that exists. And how is it kept in place? And the many ways that it's kept in place. So, isms as a suffix. So I'm driving down the freeway and I do my, because I'm from LA, I do a lot of my best thinking on the freeway, especially driving from here to Portland or whatever. And so I thought about isms, racism, sexism. Basically, you have all these different intersectional categories. And if you put eight isms on the end of what, whether it's race, sex, class, etc., and then you understand how those things are constructed, socially constructed, then you have the system that keeps it in place. So individual, structural, societal mentality. So individuals have the mentality, whether they're socialized to believe it or they're on top of the power hierarchy. There are structures that are social. That means how you talk about it, whether you have language, who socializes you, structural, societal, and then all those create a mentality, that is how you think. So not only are individuals socialized by society, they also socialize others, and they replicate that. So isms are systems of discrimination based on perceivable human differences. Now, there's a white guy named Alan Johnson who wrote a book called Power, Privilege, and Difference, and he coined the term matrix of domination. bell hooks basically says what Johnson calls the matrix of domination. She calls it white supremacist capitalist patriarchy. So they're the same. They're talking about the same thing. Bell is a little bit more raw about that. And basically, how you break down WSCP is you say, okay, you know, race is a construct. So who constructed that race where whites have power over everybody else? Supreme, basically supremacy. Capitalist, a particular form of thought that says human beings have worth and some are worth more than others. And those who are worth less make less and have less power. Patriarchy, that is, men are more superior, and the values of men are superior to those of women. So isms basically set it up so we might fear that which we don't understand, particularly if that self-knowledge leads to a form of power where it's not power over, but it's power with. If I know myself, that doesn't really threaten you, but it might threaten your concept of who you are if you accept society's definition of who you are. So, out of the black literature, the black psychological literature, because this started, and these constructs, and basically I'm the one that coined the six types of isms, but the six types of isms are basically in black literature. So I'm saying the meme can basically expand beyond race to other types of categories and the like. So type one, verbal and physical assault. Fairly self-explanatory. Type one, overt. Can be caused by individuals or can be caused by systems. But type one, overt, verbal, physical assault. Somebody called, for example, so in the reason this came out of study of race, so the legal framework, the Supreme Court basically said that the N-word, nigger, is fighting words, because if somebody uses that to me, not that it's ever happened here, they think it, they don't say it, but the designation fighting word means that I can expect, if you use that word to me, that you're about to launch some kind of physical attack, and I can use preemptive force to stop you, i.e. if we're on the playground and you call me nigger, then I can bop you. And we actually teach our children that, because in, you know, I'd rather have you get in trouble for hitting him than you just walking away. So you shouldn't walk away, because that word is illegal in federally defined workplaces. It's illegal. Okay, by Supreme Court, it's an assault.
Okay.
It's a verbal assault.
Just even saying that word is a verbal assault.
Is a verbal assault.
Okay.
Because of the history of the word.
Yeah.
Now, whether you'll win a court case or not is
good
an
luck.
Open question. But it's sufficient provocation, right?
Okay.
So
that basically you assaulting somebody else would become self-defense.
Right, so conversely, not that I mean this, okay? I call you a bitch. Is that a term of respect?
Coming from you now.
So, right? Same thing.
I mean, not you specifically, but
yeah,
man.
Right. Man, right? Right. Faggot.
Yeah.
Wop.
Are those all words that are federally...
Not all of them.
Okay.
But it's the same category, and that's what I'm trying to say. Like, poor white trash. Who actually came up with that term. Well, that's white people against white people, rich white people against poor white people. I mean, it's the same thing, okay? Verbal, physical assault intended to demean you and your character, whatever it is. So that's what I'm saying. In intersectionality, even though the original study came out of black people looking at race and talking about, okay, we have to categorize this, and the reason that we have to categorize it is Western psychology, DSM, does not recognize that racism exists. It does not.
It shouldn't be considered a mental illness.
I'm leading up to that, and I'm showing you the basis of where that comes from, how that comes from. So it's only in black psychology and people who are allied with black psychology that that is even a concept. Okay? So type one, verbal and physical assault. Type two, nonverbal, quote-unquote, microaggressions. Now, microaggressions, the studies of microaggressions, this is the original construct with Dr. Chester Pierce, who coined the term, and he basically said, yeah, that's like the nonverbal microaggressions, and Daryl Wing Sue about 2007, wrote a paper that expanded to 9 species of microaggressions. But the basic concept is they're nonverbal, but they can also be verbal, and it's not calling you the N-word or the B-word or the F-word or whatever. It's actions that seem to mean that you're less than, right? So one example is, and this has happened a couple of times, even like last week, where people, despite my being on television, despite my writing for the weekly, despite any of that stuff, people make appointments with me over the phone, and my voice can't be categorized, right? Because I speak the King's English. And I'm also part of the medical profession, and I speak like a black professional from LA. Because I'm from LA, right? So people will walk in, and they'll look for Mark Harris, and I go, that's me. And they go, oh, you don't look the way you sound over the phone.
People said that.
Yeah. Like multiple people.
A lot of people.
You know, and so when I talk about this particular story, one woman walks in and, she says, you don't look the way you sound over the phone. And, I know what she's saying, but okay.
I get called sir all the time on the phone. I'll be like, I'm a ma'am, click, done.
Okay.
That's simple.
Microaggressions, that is ascription of intelligence, because, they're not expecting your intelligence to be in your particular package because of the way they've been socialized, right? So I said, what did I look like in your mind's eye when you saw me on the phone? She said, oh, blonde hair, blue-eyed, 6'8". And I go, well,
I'm my voice.
The way, so microaggressions, are countered by micro resistance. That's the term, where you resist the aggression, right? And so you have a choice. And one of the ways is humor. Not necessarily by putting her down, but basically saying, well, I'm paid to sound white, but my voice is black at the roots. And then she blushes. Mm-hmm. And I go, you must be from Oregon. And she goes, yeah, how'd you know? And I go, okay, I'm from LA, I'm a drug counselor, I'm part of the medical profession. This is how black professionals sound in LA. I call it California newscaster English. Like, we don't have an accent. like California accent is the norm,
yeah,
right?
Chicago doesn't have
it. Chicago doesn't have an accent. New York may have Brooklyn, but that's not a newscaster English, right?
No.
Without an accent, right? Yeah. Technical English. Mm-hmm. Or, yeah, and you, have you ever noticed that things sound more credible when a British person says it? All right? So, yeah, again, there's
even
a whole prejudice.
British person is playing an American person.
Right, exactly, right? So, microaggressions, right? So, and there's more, and I don't want to really, when we cover the 20th and 21st century, you know, we'll go more into depth in that in the next class, but I just want to introduce the concept. So, individuals do type 1 and type 2, okay? Now, we have four types of institutional isms. Type 3, unconscious institutional. This is when individuals in the institution commit type 1 and type 2, but the institution neither acknowledges that happens or makes any laws against it or policies against it. And it's a stage of evolution. So it's like a stage of unconsciousness. All right? So, for example, LCC in one sense is kind of at that level where people can be discriminated on the base of race or sex or whatever, and you have to have certain rules of evidence, even though there's federal laws saying, no, you can't call somebody nigger in the workplace.
But I thought if they receive federal funds, they have to file federal law.
They do. But
the
within, well, they would say that they do try to the best of their ability, to do that. There's a complaint process, there's et cetera, et cetera. But do you necessarily feel protected or whatever? Yeah, they don't.
And one person's word is always not going to be as good as another, like the other.
When I first came here, okay, it was definitely, what, you know, 25 years ago, it was unconscious institutional. Mm-hmm. They've gotten some better in terms of, you know, officially there's some awareness, there are some policies with Title IX, et cetera, that, you know, that awareness has improved, for example.
How long ago was Title IX instituted?
The 70s.
It's not used nearly enough to hold a lot of these places accountable.
You know, so as an example, I'll say this because I can. It's public information, more or less. I have academic freedom. The year before I got here, but it was a situation that I dealt with because I dealt with a friend of the, I don't use the word victim, I use the word target. Because people are targeted.
Yes.
And you can be a moving target and you can avoid it, right? A faculty member sexually assaulted a student in his house, in his kitchen, on his wedding night.
Oh my God.
He was drunk. She chose not to press charges. Very frequent happen. Okay, so that's type one.
Yeah.
Right there. Right? Actual physical assault.
Yeah.
That's illegal. Was illegal then, in 1991.
Yeah.
Okay? But our understanding of Title IX, or at least our institutional practice about Title IX, was that we couldn't do anything because it happened off campus. Title IX actually doesn't recognize that.
No, it doesn't.
You are there, she was there because she's a student.
Yep.
He's a teacher.
Yep.
The relationship is right there.
Yeah.
Right? It doesn't matter where it occurred. The relationship is clear.
Yep.
Boom. She wouldn't have been there if he hadn't been a teacher. Boom. There it is. All right? So he was allowed to get into treatment and retire.
With full pension?
Yes. She didn't press charges. Okay?
Well,
now, yeah.
No, that'll make it easy for me.
And the way I found out about it was her friend who told me about it because she was pissed off about it. And I said, I need her to complain or to press charges or else.
Yeah.
And that was basically following the law.
Yeah.
So, yes, I'm a mandatory reporter for child abuse. And I'm a confidential employee, so people can bring me concerns, but the law says they need to report it. I can be a witness, but only once they report
it. You can consider an outcry witness.
Sure.
Yeah.
Now, that was in 1991. If that happened today, no problem. He's gone.
Yeah. And in jail.
And in jail, and right. You know, I mean, we did fire, the priest who was running cocaine with underage prostitutes and teaching writing here, et cetera. Oh, it's in the paper.
What?
I'm not.
What was the, what?
Let's just say that it was in the paper within, I mean, basically we were able to fire him because of Title IX.
There's like almost 70 other things. Universities right now that are being sued under Title IX, including UofL.
So what I'm saying in terms of unconscious, back to slide if you would, so unconscious institutional, right? So the institution has varying levels of consciousness about the law and about the things that happen, right? So part of my struggle, certainly as substance abuse prevention coordinator and federal compliance officer is, look, that was alcohol fueled. You didn't have any policies about alcohol? Oh, people come to work drunk? That's kind of illegal.
Yeah. And dangerous.
But, I have to follow the federal law, which is not the laws or practices or understanding that drug counselors have to follow, but higher ed follows, which is the same rule, because students have asked me, well, why can't we have mandatory drug testing of all faculty and students? Well, we nearly did that, but the feds backed off because the closest that we did that was having a flight technology program that worked on aircraft. And if you work on commercial or military aircraft, you definitely get drug tested. But the feds decided that because we work on civilian private aircraft, that we don't have to be drug tested. So when you drug test somebody, you have to drug test every class of people. So you can't just drug test the flight technology faculty and students. You have to drug test everybody. And the feds backed off because we essentially just work on private aircraft, not commercial and military aircraft. A very fine distinction, but again, we are following federal law. So again, that's unconscious institutional. I'm aware that people are addicted, and people are addicted in workplace, and that 80 or 90% of the drug addicts are working, so that they're going to commit certain acts. But if I can only act within the law, and there are certain practices where I can exceed the law, but not break the law in the sense that, okay, you need to go to treatment now. I have to have evidence. All right? So that's the law. Rules of evidence.
Can you force somebody into rehab?
Once you catch them or once they admit that there's a problem. Not until then.
You can make them, though. You can, against their will.
Once you have evidence or once they cop to having a problem.
Okay.
You can force them to have treatment and still have their employment.
So it's kind of like mental illness where you can only be committed.
Right. You can only be committed if you are involuntarily, if you are danger to yourself or others.
Yep.
Right. So, moving right along. Type 4, conscious institutional discrimination, constant institutionalism, and it's legal. That is, it's legal to discriminate. It is the law. So, for example, up until the Civil War, the United States was that. It remains so in the Jim Crow South. The state of Oregon was that, where it basically banned Black American free citizens from coming to Oregon. And it was allowed into the Union on that basis. And we'll talk about that in about a week or so. So, legal discrimination. The city of Eugene, legal discrimination. No people of color could live inside the city limits until the federal law made that illegal in 1965. So,
did they get with it right away or did they resist?
Do you see any ethnic neighborhoods?
No,
here?
Zero.
Okay. So, yes, discrimination is against the law now, but it was the law and it was legal to discriminate up until 1965. Not that discrimination went away. Okay? So that's type 4. Apartheid South Africa, Nazi Germany, Jim Crow South, state of Oregon, Eugene, etc. Question?
You can give a contemporary example for type 4.
Type 4? Yeah. Contemporary?
Yeah.
Let's see. Yeah. You could say that for whatever reason this is, okay? So when I gave that Lorraine Hansberry quote, so for example, this institutionalism, legal to discriminate, is often fueled by scripture or someone's interpretation of scripture, okay? So for example, they talked about the loving decision. All right, so what do you mean? If you mean by contemporary, well, within my lifetime, yeah, it was illegal to interracially marry because of scripture. Slavery was legal because the Bible said that Black people, Indians are inferior and whites are superior, and you know, et cetera, et cetera. Saudi Arabia, women can't drive.
I heard some of the reasons they can't drive.
You know, they're basically, you know, religious values, sodomy laws. So sodomy can be defined as any sexual contact that doesn't lead to a woman getting pregnant. So oral sex could be sodomy.
I think Georgia has laws.
Well, I mean, again, different states,
yeah.
You know, human sexual behavior is human sexual behavior. The reason it happens is because the body finds it pleasurable. So where, you know, homosexual male on male is illegal in some states. Gay marriage used to be illegal in some states until, so it was, you know, that's a great contemporary example right there.
Yeah, until last year.
Well, the whole bathroom thing.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Legal discrimination. Yeah, I could go on, but yeah. So, you know, as our values, not only our values, but our, you know, our scientific understanding, it, you know, changes or improves, discrimination will happen. You know, my thing, it's not just my thing, but, you know, this analysis where you have six types of isms, the idea, you know, comes out of looking at race. Okay? But it can be expanded in intersectionality to talk about other things because there are other sets of discriminators that are in play, right? So it's no longer, you know, it was once illegal for Black people heterosexually to marry in slavery.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, that's why we jumped the broom. Okay, that was an African ritual, jumping the broom, because we couldn't be Christian. that it didn't become legal for the so-called races to marry, that is black people and white people, like the Loving family, they got married in a state outside of Virginia. When they came back to Virginia, they were prosecuted for breaking the law.
Getting married
interracially, right? Heterosexual couple.
Did they make a movie about that?
The movie's coming out. Yep. Yes, they did make a movie.
It's called Loving, right?
Yeah, Loving. Heard it on NPR, so it must be true.
Documentary on Facebook, like a little documentary thing on it.
Yeah. So, one of the reasons that black people kind of have been at the forefront of civil rights struggle is, okay, you can't discriminate against black people anymore, but that was biblically based, the King James Version of the Bible, or a interpretation of the King James Version of the Bible. So now we can't be discriminated against overtly, so they target other folks. So, gay marriage, et cetera, and other forms of sexuality and religion and
they always others. Use ridiculous things like bestiality. It's all for let gays get married. Next it's going to be this.
Yeah. Well, the other piece with that is if we look at who is committing child pornography and child abuse and child sexual abuse, the majority of that is heterosexuals.
Yeah.
Nobody's pedophiles, whatever. Nobody's banning them. Oh, boy. We are banning them, but we're not targeting them because they're heterosexual.
Is that what I've noticed, at least with a lot of people, is that they refuse to acknowledge the fact that if a man is touching a kid, they automatically determine, they say that they're gay instead of saying they're a pedophile, and they don't understand the difference
right.
between them.
Well, and they may not be. Back to slide, please. Thanks. Type 5. Conscious institutional illegal. All right? So discrimination has been made illegal. With type 5, it's usually, remember, so type 3 through 6 are all institutional. That means they're basically taken by organizations that take collective action. Okay? Discrimination is illegal, but they still do it because it's profitable. So this could be job discrimination, this could be housing, this could be any number of things. School,
university
admissions, all kinds of different ways. A contemporary example of that, that happened to be in this town, is redlining. So redlining literally is, I happen to have a pen.
Awesome.
Redlining is a form of type 5 that is committed by financial institutions. Banks, real estate, insurance, all right? It's how ghettos are made, for example, okay? So on this, they literally draw a red line on a map, and inside, it costs more to get insurance, or they'll deny you insurance if you live in that area. And guess who decides who lives in that area? And so for example, so in the thing that happened to me, I was buying my first house in Eugene. I'd been working here for 2 years. My father, the doctor, had a bunch of money he needed to get rid of for tax purposes. So he's coming in on the down payment. And we were essentially coming in at 20% down. Right? So normally you can basically come in with like 3% or whatever the figure is, but we were coming in at 20.
And if it's subprime, you mean?
Right. Well, yeah. This is basically prime rate real estate, right? So we come to the just before closing, and the bank says, there's a problem with your loan. So I go in and I say, okay, what's the problem? They say, well, you live in a below average desirability location. I go, what does that mean? Is there a ghetto? Because knowing that there's no ghetto here in Eugene, right?
No.
It's not the Whitaker. So what does that mean? Below, well, you live across the street from an insurance office and a chiropractor. And I go, yeah, how is that below average desirability location? So it was like, I don't live there anymore, I sold the house, but 10th and Chambers. All right, so, but on the other side of Chambers, you know, you could, actually the real estate agent said, you know, yeah, I could get you, you know, housing values are more. I go, wait, a block, really? So Chambers used to be the outer edge of Eugene, because where Cesar Chavez School is now used to be the airport, right? And on the old maps, you can basically call it Jigaboo Flats, right? Because it was outside of the city limits and black people lived outside of the city limits. I said, so what's the deal? Below average desirability location, is it a ghetto? No, it's an insurance agent. We want 5% more. In other words, 25% down. I go, first of all, you're going to sell off the loan in a year. So I'm not sure how $5,000 improves your financial position. Try to be logical. Well, we want 25% down. I think it's, so eliminate the strategy, because that's kind of like a microaggression, except, you know, microaggressions are type two. You eliminate all the possibilities before you play the race card. I think it's redlining. And they go, and I'm meeting with them face to face. We didn't know you were black. You what? You didn't know I was black. Well, you didn't check the box. I said, yeah, Dad told me not to check the box. He said, I don't want any problems with the loan. None. All right. So I also happen to know, because I'm a federal compliance officer and I do consult and work with the feds, that it's voluntary for me to check the box, but you have to based on visual inspection. He said, yeah, your father didn't check the box. You didn't check the box. You guys checked the box after I left. And what would you have checked? Is it my Choctaw cheekbones? And my father's name is Hiawatha, right? So what would you check for him? Well, black. Okay, so what's this you telling me that you didn't know that I was black? I think it's redlining. Well, it's not us, it's Portland. Tell this key bank. And, you know, I can name them because, yeah, a lot of people do, a lot of banks do this. You know, Wells Fargo does illegals. Yeah, they all do it.
That's right? Why I do credit union.
And that's why you have to know your rights. Know the law, know your history, and know how to fight this correctly without a lawyer. So I said, I think it's, tell Portland it's redlining. Well, I don't think that will make any difference. All right. Let me get back to you. This was on a Thursday. So I called Dad, and he said, no, this is why I didn't want you to check the box, but okay, what do you want to do? I said, let me call the feds. And so I called up a man named Gilbert Mora. I found out, okay, where is, who is their federal regulator, FDIC or whatever. So call up Region 10 FDIC, talk to a man named Gilbert Mora, without mentioning any of, you know, just gave him, he said, that's redlining. I go, great. What do you want to do now? He said, I want the file. okay. So Friday, I go to the office downtown and I go, all right, I'd like the file. Well, no, you can't have it. Wait, I paid for everything, the appraisal, all that information that's in the file. You have all my information, which I paid for. I want the file. Well, why do you want the file? Well, it's not to get a new loan somewhere else. Gilbert Mora wants the file. Well, who's he? Head of Region 10 FDIC, your federal regulator. He thinks it's redlining. He wants the file. Well, he has to request it. I'll let him know that. Meanwhile, I want an answer on my loan Monday.
Bet you got an answer.
Tuesday. Right? And, you know, at closing, I was, you know, Dad said, I've never seen you so angry. You're just like throwing out these one-liners, these clips. Yeah, I want, you know, I want the deed that says, you know, no black people can live in this particular place because they exist. And again, we'll show you that in the 20th century when we get to that next term. But
Cory Booker talked about his parents had to send a white person to look and do all the house showings, and then on a day of closing, his parents show up and like,
yes,
what?
Yes, that happened with a contemporary black family here.
Yep.
So, yeah.
The white people showed up. They like hired actors basically to show up for every single thing up until the day of closing, and then shows up and signs it and says.
So they attempted to redline. So redlining. Conscious, institutional, illegal. But the rules, even though it's against the law, the rules of evidence basically define the policies and procedures for issuing a complaint.
That's why everybody has to make copies nowadays.
Right. Type 6. Socio-structural violence. This is probably where the body, well, not probably, it is where the body count is. So socio-structural violence was first defined by Frantz Fanon, who is a revolutionary black psychiatrist, trained in Martinique, France. Well, actually a French colony. Martinique's a French colony in the Caribbean. He trained in Paris, was stationed in Algiers. What he basically found and basically coined this term because patients were segregated by race, but black patients and white patients with the exact same diagnosis got different treatment. The white patients got talk therapy and drugs. The black patients got torture in the 1950s. Okay, it's a form of institutional racism. So he's basically saying, okay, why is this happening? Because there's no medical reason for it. But it's normalized.
It's still going on.
And there are many forms of it. And this is the most widespread. So for example, contemporary examples, because now you got me on that whole thing, right? Drug treatment. Who gets treatment, who gets jail? That's racially split, even though they have the same diagnosis. Mm-hmm. Who, when Ronald and Nancy said, just say no, 80% of the illegal drug users were white men who made in excess of $50,000. That's 80%, this is according to the feds, right? So during that time, 80% were illegal drug users were white men who made in excess of $50,000, i.e. Congress, i.e. Trump, i.e.
Wall Street. Any major
13% were white women. Okay, so if you've done the math, followed the math, that's 7% for all minorities.
Yep.
Black people were 3% of that 7. Yet, who was going to jail?
Black people.
Selling drugs to white people. Okay? Who was in the prison? So when we're talking about the prison industrial complex, the school to prison pipeline, et cetera, that those are forms of socio-structural violence. The new Jim Crow, socio-structural violence. It's discrimination, it's legal, and it's prevalent throughout society. And so basically Fanon talked about, okay, the way you overcome that is collective action.
The 1-to-100 ratio is as racist as it gets in terms of drugs.
Were you talking about
crack versus cocaine?
Yeah.
1 gram of crack is equal to 100 grams of cocaine.
It's the same. It's the same drug. Powder cocaine basically can be made into crack. So, yeah.
But one was, you know, 15 years to, well, 1 gram of crack and 100 grams of cocaine were equal to like 15 years or 5 years in prison, mandatory.
Yeah. And there's lots of different types of socio-structural violence. It's being the most prevalent, and it also, basically, that's where the body count is in terms of people dying. So, you know, what we were talking about before camera. So, especially in the last week, so white killers of cops get taken alive. Unarmed black people get killed by cops. So it was, you know, interesting whether it was Iowa or Georgia or whatever, they actually killed cops or shot cops.
And, there was like three incidents in the last week.
And they are being taken alive rather than killed
by the police. And when they are being shot by the police, they're being shot in non-lethal manners.
That's interesting.
They're not unloading their weapons. They're not doing kill shots. None of that.
Yeah. So... socio-structural violence. So, this comes from Thomas and Sillen's book, Racism and Psychiatry. So, it talks about historical scientific racism. So, for example, have I talked about Samuel Cartwright yet? Okay. So, Samuel Cartwright was a psychologist that was a contemporary of Benjamin Rush, who is the American Psychological, so founded the American Psychological Association. So Rush himself was anti-slavery, abolitionist. Samuel Cartwright was not. So he created and formulated two mental illnesses, of which I have both of them congenitally.
I wonder if I have one.
Drapetomania aegypticus and diesthesia ethiopicus.
I know about the drapetomania one.
Okay, drapetomania, the flight from home malady. So in other words, slaves are mentally ill for wanting to escape slavery.
Yeah, to be free.
To escape slavery.
Yeah, that was crazy. That was legit created.
All right? And diesthesia ethiopicus, basically also known as rascality, so wherever they do sabotage or they don't work or whatever, that is basically attributed to their racial origin. And he formulated that.
If you didn't do anything, if you didn't contribute or something like that to society, then...
No, if you were a slave... And you basically, you know, burn down the building. Rebel in any way, being a rascal. But
you were mentally ill.
You were mentally ill, right? So there's nothing wrong with slavery, because slavery is normal.
I'm pretty sure I got the
Drapetomania aegypticus, yes. I know I do congenitally as well. So that became part of the APA, and that's why to this day, probably why, this is my speculation, but the American Psychological Association to this day does not recognize that racism exists. It doesn't recognize that sexism exists, that you can have any psychological effect from racism or sexism.
Did those two psychological things get thrown out after a while, or...?
Theoretically, but they
morph into something else.
I may be heterosexist in saying this, but it basically is an observable truth. Does the LGBT lobby have more pull than the black psychological lobby? So that they have gender identity dysphoria.
Well, they just...
As part of DSM-5, yeah. But no ethnic identity dysphoria?
Yeah.
So gender identity dysphoria means that you have feelings about your sexuality based on what society says. Would we have any feelings about what our ethnic identity is because of what society says? We would. Would we have that going for much longer as far as acknowledgement? Yes, we would. So it would seem that we could basically categorize racism as a mental illness, and I'll walk you through how that happens, okay? So, historical scientific racism. In its long and ugly history in the United States, white racism has improvised on 1,000 variations on 2 basic themes. 1, black people are born with inferior brains and a limited capacity for growth. 2, their personality tends to be abnormal, whether by nature or by nurture.
So it doesn't matter, they're just abnormal.
Well, I did interviews with some personnel who recently retired from the Department of Youth Services. They told me, and I quote, I don't know, I was basically part of a team doing a cultural competency study. This is in 1992.
I'm afraid.
One man said, so they had concerns about my objectivity. So one man said, I don't know why all this focus on cultural competency. I can get a suntan and know more about their culture than they do. And this was a white man with red hair.
He can't get a suntan.
He can't get a suntan. The man next to him said, these people have a criminal culture, and that culture is the same as their ethnicity. Okay? So what Sillin and Thomas are saying, okay, this guy was a U of O graduate. So, in other words, okay, your criminality is your ethnicity. This is not a new concept. It was not new to this guy. He accepted it as fact. These people have a criminal culture, whether it's black or Hispanic or Native American, and they're criminals. They're born criminals. They can't escape it, right? So these concepts of inferiority and pathology are interrelated and reinforce each other. Both have served to sanctify a hierarchical social order in which, quote, the Negro's place, unquote, is forever ordained by his genes and the accumulated disabilities of his past. Okay, so we can't ever improve. This would lead to, for example, and I won't get into this till we get to the 20th century, but O.J. Simpson says on Geraldo, God made a mistake in making me black. Now, how would he get that idea? Not from his black mom in Hunter's Point, and not from his first black wife. And if God made a mistake in making you black and you couldn't be white, the next best thing would be getting a trophy wife. And what does a trophy wife look like? Come on. Blonde, blue-eyed, yeah.
Pretty, young.
And if you were domestically violent with your black wife, it follows you be domestically violent with your trophy wife, because where do you get the concept, if I can't have you, no one can? Huh, where would that come from? Well, gee, so when we're talking about intersectionality.
He also has a kid with his first wife.
And yes, a couple of kids.
Some mental illness too.
Couple of kids. So all I'm saying is, maybe these things are kind of interrelated in terms of, you know, developing therapy. Now, obviously, Prozac, you know, obviously, I'm biased. I hate O.J. Simpson. Mostly because he didn't embrace any degree of blackness until he got in trouble. And, you know, he did what every white man in his station could do. Lawyer up, get the best lawyer, and get you off. So part of what we're dealing with here is he didn't do anything that white men have not done before them in terms of murdering somebody and getting off. That's not what Martin Luther King
killed three people.
There is that. So part of the issue for me is looking at, okay, he's crazy. He's mentally ill, okay, as an effect of racism. Now, Prozac's not going to help him.
No.
Right? So that's what the drug therapy is not going to help him, but some forms of talking therapy might.
Behavioral.
Right? So when we're talking about then, to continue on, so the traditional corollary to that view, says Thomas and Stillen, is that black people function best when they stay in their place, i.e. inferior to whites. Social tasks and privileges normal to white men are too stressful for the black man. Blacks living in unnatural freedom in the North were prone to insanity. Mental health was associated with contentment with a subordinate place in society. Protest was a sign of derangement.
Oh my God.
Okay, so this is, when we're talking about some of the conditions in slavery, where we're looking at free blacks living in society, when we're talking about these revolutionary citizens in your reading, they are operating under, well, they're anomalies, and they're looked at with some degree of suspicion. Dr. Samuel Cartwright, so drapetomania.
These were all his ideas.
These were his ideas,
all
but
this?
He was not the only one.
Well, obviously, they got adopted.
He was not the only one. So this is actually what the scientific thought was at the time. So reasonable, rational. And that's one of the things about science.
Was phrenology still around at this time?
Phrenology was still around at this time. Right.
That makes sense.
Okay? So it's not a bad idea to be scientifically literate, but science by itself can come to the wrong conclusions. That's why you should question it.
Depending on who it's paid for.
Oh, wait. Yeah. Depending on who it's paid for. So this is from their book, Racism Psychiatry, by Thomas and Stillen. So in the historical view of these scientists, blacks had smaller, less complex, and less evolved brains. Does this sound familiar? Like the same argument was being used for women? Smaller brains, less complex. They're simple creatures.
Yet men still can't figure us out.
So one theory of racial superiority basically held, you know, the Caucasians or Caucasoids were the superior race that evolved after the biblical flood. So remember those constructs of race, Caucasoid, Mongoloid, Negroid, that was also promoted from the German university. So Sir Robert Downes, Down syndrome, basically held that Mongolism or Mongoloid features in people with that form of mental retardation were evidence of the inferior of Asian people. That's why it was called that. Now, he's in Britain and he's studying white people who are basically having children with what we call fetal alcohol spectrum. These are white folks with Asian features. Right? Yes. Caused by alcohol poisoning in the womb.
Asian features because of that fetal alcohol.
What they called Asian features, epicanthic folds, et cetera, et cetera. And because they were mentally retarded, mongoloid idiots is the term, right? Because of that, it basically fit into that social theory. Now, that's Caucasoid, Mongoloid, Negroid has been discredited with the turn kind of the 20th century, from the 19th century to the 20th century, but it's still in effect with some people and some people's thought. All right? So today we call them developmentally disabled, and FAS spectrum is one of the most preventable sources of mental disability, development disabled disabilities that are common. So even those views were widely held and formed official policy well into the 20th century, right? So social structural violence. Okay, so this one, Fanon talks about, look, this, people can rationalize these beliefs and they can have scientific backing. So that's why it takes collective action. So, health consequences of racism on African Americans. So 300 years of slavery, followed by 100 plus years of legally and socially reinforced apartheid, supported by acts of terrorism, which only ended legally 38 years ago plus. Yeah, at the time. This was in 2008. It's gone.
Oh, okay. I was gone. Like,
it's
wait, what?
Obviously higher now. Obviously, yeah. Yeah, right. A little longer than that, all right? So, direct health consequences tied to types 1, 2, 3 of forms of discrimination. And disproportionate stress-related chronic diseases, tobacco and alcohol addiction, overeating, heart disease, stroke, diabetes, cancer. So, for example, then black people, for example, are like 13% of the population, and they smoke a third of the cigarettes. Because where is this tobacco marketing?
Well, they only market certain ones, though.
Yeah. Well,
only like Newports and Cools and the most
addictive, the most cancer-causing, targeted specifically to black people.
And in white neighborhoods, it's usually like Marlboros and Pall Malls and stuff like that.
Yeah.
At least in Chicago.
So that's another form of social structural violence. The more black people die every year from alcohol and tobacco, 60,000 plus, than the Ku Klux Klan killed in lynchings in its entire history, saying that's 10,000. That's just recorded. Probably is, but you know, in order to say it, the standard is it has to be recorded. Right? All right, so cigarettes and alcohol, often drugs of choice for stress relief. Mental health services are not accessed as frequently by African Americans. And when black people, for example, are correctly diagnosed with any disease, it's usually at a later, more difficult stage to treat than whites, if it gets treated at all. This phenomenon is called health disparity, also medical apartheid. Health disparities are a form of racism that is type 6, socio-structural violence. And type 6 produces the largest number of negative health outcomes and negative consequences, and disease, including disease and death, incarceration, all through the normal actions of a society.
We actually saw something like that in Chicago when they took the level 1 trauma unit out of the south side where all the shootings happened.
Mm.
And so everybody was dying on their way to Stroger, which is all the way on the west side of Chicago.
Mm. Okay, so socio-structural violence is designed, not accidental. Poverty is economic violence, which is also not an accident. It's also structured. So another form of socio-structural violence. So, racism as a mental illness. Judy Katz, a researcher, educator, who identified racism as a disease, a critical and pervasive form of mental illness. Racism, she writes, has all the classic elements of destructive behavior, including acting out, denial of reality, projection, transference of blame, disassociation, and justification, basically all classic symptoms of Western described schizophrenia. All of them.
That's all like the Trump supporters.
Hmm?
That's like all the Trump supporters.
All of Trump supporters. Hmm. Well.
For real. Like, that's them in a nutshell.
I'm not saying that, but that, you know.
I am.
DSM describes what schizophrenics are, and psychosis is basically believing in a reality that nobody else does, objectively. So, I mean, this is part of why, you know, my father and other people like, you know, Chet Pierce and Al Poussin have basically been fighting this 50-year battle with DSM. They're all shrinks. I just named
your
black shrinks.
Shrink?
Yeah.
Oh, your dad is. Okay.
Yeah, my dad's a shrink. So this 50-year battle about with APA about classifying racism as a mental illness. And the resistance from APA is, well, if we pathologize racism, it's so widespread, we'd have to decide that society is crazy.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Well, okay, but fine. Maybe you're not willing to do that, but, and then we're basically saying, well, Prozac is not going to help this particular form of mental illness. But you could design therapy for the targets of racism. So that they could cope.
They just need to tell the truth in history books.
Well, they're not going to do that directly.
And stop creating this fantasy of white supremacy.
One way this disease manifests is through the delusion of white superiority. The author cites six studies dated from 68 to 72. This book first came out in 85. So, racism is mental illness.
Is that what the book is?
It's called White Racism.
Okay.
She's, I believe, Jewish. The delusion of white superiority manifests itself as arrogance coupled with disdain for everything that is non-white. This is perpetuated by deliberate omission, falsification, and emphasis leading to a belief that everything great, make America great again, that was ever done was the work of whites. We built this country. I mean, this is what I heard. We built this country. Like,
No, you didn't.
No, we actually physically built it, but okay. Right.
And I'm still trying to figure out what this great time in America was that we need to go back to.
I think it's the 50s.
That wasn't a great time for anybody but white, rich
males. We're not necessarily seeing anybody else. So we'll leave it here. And this will be up on the website in about an hour.
And this is why I live in America. I can't do this for the rest of my life.
Nazi Josio Maria Sika and people.